الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي أما بعد. Basically, we began with the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whenever we mention Allah, bi-idhnillah, there's barakah, there's blessing in whatever speech. And I asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make my speech smooth. Basically, I asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow the Canadian accent and American accent to be understood by the British amongst you, all of you. So, and all that dua basically encompasses all these meanings. Ya Allah, what's that, what Musa have made dua when he was about to meet who? Fir'aun, right? He made that dua. We ask Allah, not saying that you're Fir'aun. No. No, I'm just saying it. So this is a dua that he used. So we'll begin with that. I'm very honored. I'm very happy. Wallahi, Allah is my witness that I was invited by your Aisha. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from all of us. Say ameen. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this step that you've taken to learn about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to learn about your deen, as means to expiate all of your sins. Not just that, but also elevate your status. And whenever a dua is mentioned, do not belittle the word ameen. Do not belittle the dua itself. Pay attention. As Muslims, the moment we belittle dua, just the moment you do that, the moment you give dua and you say, 99.999%, Allah will not accept 99.99%. Allah will not accept that. Allah accepts only 100%. That's what the Prophet teaches me and you, correct? Would you mind if you hold that? See, like any of you here was hesitant whether the brother Zallah Khair will take the paper from me when I requested him to take it? No one was hesitant, right? Anybody here was worried, oh my God, the brother, what's your name again? Mahmoud is going to embarrass Brother Majid. Oh my God, he's going to embarrass him. Don't ask him to take the papers. You're like, brother, you're weird. Of course he will accept your request and take the papers from you, correct? None of you doubted. Shame on me and shame on others who, when they make dua, think that Allah will not accept. Is it clear? Because the Prophet ﷺ said, "Udru Allah wa antum muqinuna bi ijaba," call upon Allah while you're 100% certain, more than the certainty that you all had, that this brother Mahmoud will take the papers from me. Is that clear? So when I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the moment that we leave this hall, just like how the Prophet ﷺ said, the moment we all leave, no matter how boring this lecture was, no matter how little you are understood, all your sins will be forgiven bi idhnillah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another thing, for the sake of time, I would give a word to the brother that I will not end beyond 3:15, inshallah. Okay? So no matter how devastating the lecture becomes, know that this torture will end by 3:15. Okay? And if it was so good, then sadness will begin at 3:15. Okay? So whatever the way you look at it. And just for the sake of just beginning the talk, this is not part of the topic. You know, there are people that are always negative, right? Just like, you know, the cup is half empty, this understanding. So the brother who did the poster, please upgrade the iPhone to the iPhone 4S or 5, please. Jazakallah khair. May Allah bless you for that. The lipstick, I had to minimize the window when my wife had to walk into the room. What lecture are you giving? No, but my wife understood that. Jazakallah khair. So overall, it was beautiful poster, beautiful trailer. May Allah bless all of you. Another thing I'd like to mention about your iStock, you guys, the special thing about you that I noticed, the manners. Manners, your manners are beautiful. Brother didn't even meet me. The brothers and sisters that I met in your iStock already represented you. You guys paying attention? So whatever first person I saw, a brother or a sister that had a good attitude, we're human beings. By default, I had to label all of you that you're as good as that brother, if not even better. Is that clear? So just keep that beautiful manners, because wallahi, this is the heaviest thing on Yawm al-Qiyamah. Not your salah. No. Not your siyam. It is your good manners. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to beautify our manners, just like how He beautified what? Our physical features. Is it clear? That's a dua of Rasulullah sallallahu. Before I begin, any questions before I begin? I know the question will be sent in terms of the content, but so far, any questions that you have? Any questions? Feel free, so don't be shy. Okay, that's good, no problem. We're ready to begin? Okay. Just a few seconds, renew your intentions, why you're here. Well, just because I had to drop Brother Majid the lecture, that's why I'm here. La, why you're here? Just between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just a few seconds, just update the intention that I'm only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not because that girl's in that hall, so therefore I want to impress her father-in-law and all that stuff. No. I'm here for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just have that feeling with yourself a little bit. Just a few seconds. Okay, Bismillah ar-Rahim. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and every time you hear that beautiful name, every single time you hear that name, you say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wallahi, if the only thing you come out of this lecture, the only thing is saying 10, 15, 20 times sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's enough of a benefit, of the reward and the blessing that comes out of it. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was sitting with the Sahaba and he said, يُوشِكُ الْأُمَمُ أَن تَدَاعَ عَلَيْكُمْ. Soon the ummas, many ummas, not one, all the people will gather around you and crush you and take from you the way as if they'll invite one another to eat from one dish. The Sahaba were very worried. They said, Ya Rasulullah, وَمِنْ قِلَّةٍ نَحْنِ يَوْمَئِذٍ. Is it because we'll be small in numbers? That's why they will all gather against us. He said, لا بل أنتم يومئذٍ كثير. Rather, on that day you'll be millions and billions and a huge massive number. However, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, ولكنكم غثاء كغثاء السيل. You'll be like the foam of the ocean, weightless, have no identity. Like you sold your, basically your traits of a Muslim. There's an identity theft that took place and all that. That's why you'll be taken so lightly. That's why a Muslim, not one Muslim, thousands of Muslims would die in one city. And the news will make it as a tense segment in the basic of the news. The first one is one guy that died in another country who's not a Muslim. But the Muslims were no longer valuable. You say the whole Ukraine issue, the whole this, and we don't go into politics. But what about the Rohingya? What about all the brothers and sisters over there? And what about other places? Why is it? Let's be very frank and honest. Our value as Muslims is not like a regular other human being value. Let's be very blunt and honest. Isn't that right? I'm talking even from a Canadian perspective. Our Prime Minister, he traveled all the way to China. You know why? For a panda. For a panda to bring all the way back to Canada. And he took it so seriously because that panda was sick. And then to bring it all the way to Canada and basically cure it and so on. What about the Muslims? Is it clear? So the Prophet ﷺ is saying this. Then he says, not just that they will take come over you. In addition, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, due to you not being strong with your Muslim identity, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will extract from the heart of those that don't like you, what? Al-mahabata minkum. So basically they will not even see you, wait, like you have no weight in front of their eyes. You have no value. So they're like, okay, I'll kill 100 of you guys, you're worthless anyways. So there's no, we mean nothing to them. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, وَلَيَقْذِفَنَّ اللَّهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمُ الْوَهْنِ. And due to that as well, Allah will put something in the Muslim's heart. What is it? He said, الْوَهْنِ. The Sahaba did not understand that word. Rasulullah, what is الْوَهْنِ? He said, حُبُّ الدُّنْيَا وَأَيْشْ كَرَاهِيَةِ الْمَوْتِ. Which is the love of dunya. You'll be obsessed about dunya. That's all what matters in your life. And then you will hate death more than anything. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after he said that, he ended the hadith. With this being said, brothers and sisters, we got a problem. The problem is that we live at a time, and I, as a speaker, I like to be very frank and blunt. I don't like to sugarcoat things and give the good image and hide the bad image. I don't like to do that stuff. You guys agree? Especially at the young age, correct? So Rasulullah, I'm saying this, it shows that there's a problem that will be emerging, is that many of us will not be very proud of the identity. People may not be proud of the beard, might not be proud of the hijab, might not be proud of the salah, might not be proud that I'm respecting my mom. Some guy will be saying, oh, my mom told me to clean my bed in front of my friend John, Mike, Ahmed, whatever it may be. It is embarrassing if I follow the commandment of my mom, then they leave that commandment. So the identity of respecting parents, the identity as a Muslim that you know if your mom tells you to do something, it becomes an obligation. If you don't do so, you're sinful. It shows you that if you want to go to Taraweeh, your mom says, no, wash the dishes. As a Muslim identity, it tells you, go wash the dishes over Taraweeh. But this whole misconception is coming, and the identity is basically fading away. With this problem being mentioned, people now, they seek honor, reputation, what dignity and pride from other resources, materialist, right? iPhone right here, as long as they have this S3 or S4, no, I got an S4, mashallah, you're S3, you're miskeen, right? And all the understanding, what car are you driving? It's all about now, you're basically labeled, your value is according to the materialistic thing that you have. When in the past, it was about whatever in the heart. And I'll show you more as we go through. Now, what's the concern? You're like, okay, that's a problem that we seek might, honor, respect, we shape our identity from other things, okay? From the car that we have, from the girlfriend that I have, from this, this and that. What's our problem? What's the concern? The concern to all of you is two. Number one, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches me and you that the only source of might, honor, and respect and dignity is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, period. Only one source. Allah said in the Quran, بعد عودة الرجيم بسم الله الرحيم من كان يريد العزة فلله العزة جميعا. Whoever wants honor, might, respect, dignity, and all that good stuff, it is only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the only source. There's no second, there's no third, there's no difference of opinion. طيب, what's the other concern? The other concern, if you wish to continue to pursue other avenues to look cool and not from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's not just that you will not get the results that you're seeking. What will happen? You'll completely face the opposite of what you sought. So Rasulullah ﷺ teaches us that Allah said in the Quran, وَمَن يَبْتَغِ غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَن يُقْبَلَ مِنْهُ وَهُوَ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Whoever does not want to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whoever does not want to fulfill the commandments of Allah and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it will not be accepted. And at the end, what did Allah say? الْخَاسِرِينَ, which means you'll be amongst the losers. Isn't that right? The other ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلِلَّهِ الْعِزَّةُ وَلِرَسُولِهِ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Izzah will only be given by Allah to the Prophet and to the believers. No third. وَلَكِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. However, the hypocrites will not understand, will not acknowledge what is said. We ask Allah to purify all of our hearts. Say ameen. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, had I been a hypocrite, ya Allah, guide me. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect all of us. To sum this up, brothers and sisters, in one quick story of all what I mentioned, in one story, Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. In an authentic hadith, when he was the Khalifa, he wasn't the ruler of all the Muslim countries, what happened? He personally wanted to take the keys to what city? Which city? He was invited, can you please come over, now take over that city. What city was it?
Jerusalem.
Barakallahu feekum. So Umar al-Khattab, valuing that city, out of every city that was conquered by the Muslims, this one specifically, for the honor it has, he's like, I'm the Khalifa of over like 22 countries, I will personally go all the way to Palestine, to Jerusalem. While he was there, what happened? Umar al-Khattab, as he was walking, he found a pond full of like mud, okay? He was over a camel. He went off the camel, took off his shoes, put it on his shoulders, grabbed the reins of the camel, and walked through that mud. As a man who's an expert with the horseback riding, etc., he knew this was the best way to cross the mud. Is it clear? When he crossed, what happened? Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah, radiallahu anhu, one of the greatest companions, he said, Ya Umar, أَأَنْتَ تَفْعَلُ هَذَا? Oh Umar, did you just do that? Look at your shin, look at your feet, look at this. Is that an image that you want to give about the Muslims? Is this something you want to go and meet the Roman? He's not basically feeling embarrassed. No. Don't misunderstand Abu Ubaidah. Abu Ubaidah is worried that Umar will not be respected the way he deserves to be respected. He's paying attention. Umar is not embarrassed about Islam. No. I don't want Umar to be disrespected. Then Umar, what did Umar say? Awwah, that's the Arabic term. You just didn't say that, Abu Ubaidah. Oh my God, if it was someone else, I would have shown him the real deal. I.e. I would have made him a symbol of like disgrace. Abu Ubaidah, pay attention. And now this nasihah is to all of us. Abu Ubaidah, we were the most humiliated people that ever walked the face of this earth. Okay? We're humiliated. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent us Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we gained the izzah. فَمَنِ ابْتَغَى الْعِزَّةَ مِنْ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ. And whoever sought honor, respect, dignity, and might from any other thing besides Allah, what will happen? أَذَلَّنَا اللَّهِ. Allah will humiliate us. With this being said, we should be proud as Muslims. As Muslims, don't be shy about whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded upon you. With this being said, some people get so pumped up, and bismillah, go with it, but we'll have to tune up whatever I just mentioned in the following minutes. Now, when it comes to izzah, when it comes to honor, what name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes to your mind? It's very simple. What name of Allah comes to your mind when we talk about izzah, might, honor, and respect? Go ahead, give it a shot. What name of Allah?
Al-Aziz.
Al-Aziz, right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Aziz, and He's the only one basically who gives that source of might. Knowing Allah's beautiful names help you a lot within your life. Wallahi, you cannot imagine how helpful it is when you learn Allah's beautiful names. I'll give an example, okay? Someone did so many sins. And who amongst us doesn't sin to begin with? Who not? Every one of us sin, right? One time there was a high school student in Canada, I'll never forget the story in my life. I was saying this, that all of us sin and so on. He jumped up and he said, brother, my parents sin? My parents? He's a high schooler, like he's actually 16 years old, 15 years old. He's not like a child. I'm like, yes, your parents sin. He's like, no, you didn't say that. I'm like, wallah, your mom and dad sin. Brother, are you kidding me? I've never seen them sinning. I'm like, you know what? Even the imam sins. The one who we pray behind sins? Yes, because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, كُلُّ إِبْنِ آدَمَ خَطَّاءٌ. The Prophet said, every single one of us commits sin and mistakes. Now, who is the best one who gets an F? Or a mistake or a failure? Are those who try to improve. وَخَيْرُ الْخَطَّائِينَ التَّوَّابُونَ. Isn't that right? The best of those who do mistakes are those that say, I'm sorry right away, they apologize. They don't take so much time. They don't say, okay, when I get married, I'll do this. When I go for Hajj, khalas, I'll no longer date. I won't go clubbing anymore. Hajj, and you know this whole concept of delay? No. They go right away to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this can be summed up that Allah will definitely forgive you with knowing what? You know a lot of ayat. Allah says, Allah will forgive those who sin, etc., right? But there's one thing, had you know, you don't really need to know much after that. is once you know that Allah, one of His names is At-Tawwab. That's all you gotta know. One word, that's all. Allah At-Tawwab means the one who accepts your return. Allahu Akbar. Can you believe this? It's as simple as that. And Allah will never call Himself a name that He will not fulfill. Allahu Akbar. So now Allah Al-Aziz, going back to Allah Al-Aziz. Al-Aziz, there are about four meanings that come to it for you to comprehend. Number one, Al-Aziz, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what does it mean? The one that has no peer or equal. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There's nothing like him. That's why the Arab, they say, عَنْدَهُ خِبْرَ عَزِيزَ, which means he has a unique experience. So Allah is unique, there's nothing like him. Other meaning out of four, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means the one who's unstoppable. No one can stop him. No one can defeat him, okay? You might have a soccer team, football, I apologize. You might have a football team, okay, that is absolutely marvelous. Khalas, they're doing amazing. What's your team from Sheffield? What team is it? Sheffield United? I don't know. I know a little bit about soccer, but I've never heard that name before. Okay, you guys have a good team, mashallah, okay? Sheffield United. Is it like the first division or something? Oh, like Miskeen? So you guys are not really athletic, huh? Because I was just told that Wednesday is a good day because it's like all you guys go for athletic and like sports and so on, right? Wednesday is what's dedicated for. So I see all you guys are here on Wednesdays. That means that you guys are not athletic at all. May Allah bless all of you. Say ameen. Right. With this being said, what was I talking about? Yes. Wallahu ghalibun ala amr. You might find a team that is always victorious, but eventually it will lose. You might find a boxer that's always winning, never loses, but eventually that boxer will lose. Is it clear? But the one who's always a winner and will never be lost is Allah Aziz. The one who's unstoppable. What's the ayah? وَاللَّهُ غَالِبٌ عَلَى أَمْرِهِ وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Allah is always victorious. If Allah is on your side, you will never basically what? Lose. Allahu Akbar. Is it clear? That's why Allah gives you might. The other meaning was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-Aziz when it comes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who reinforces His slaves with support, with soldiers to make you victorious, to make you aziz. Is it clear? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran in Surah Yasin, إِذْ أَرْسَلْنَا إِلَيْهِ مُثْنَيْنِ فَكَذَّبُهُمَا then فَعَزَّزْنَا اللَّهُ, which means that Allah reinforced the prophets with another prophet to make that basically the ummah focus on Islam. Is it clear? Focus on Islam, focus on the speaker as well. طيب, with this being mentioned, Rasulullah ﷺ mentions more of this to make us proud. So from now on, even though your name is Mahmoud, Abdullah, etc., you're also Abdul Aziz. You're the slave of Al Aziz. You walk around, I'm the slave of Al Aziz. Brother, my name is Ahmed. No, you're also Abdul Aziz. You are Amat Al Aziz, right? You're proud of your deen. You're proud of your Lord. I'm the slave of the unstoppable. Do something about it. Boof, punch in the face. Like, whoa, I didn't expect that, right? But at the end of the day, no matter what life does to you, you're always holding your value. Wallahi, if the whole world starts to step on you and ruin you, you will still be mighty and still be powerful. You know what? An example came to my mind. Who has this? SubhanAllah, it came to my mind, and inshallah, it will work out, inshallah. What I meant is that when you're the slave of Allah Al-Aziz, nothing in the world, no matter how much you get beaten up, people try to humiliate you, wallah, at the end of the day, you'll be honored. Let's take, for example, I don't want the queen, I might get in trouble. Let me use the American dollar. The guy died. Okay. Okay. So you go here, and you know what? I'll give you guys actually even more than that. I'll give you one of the highest currencies in Canada, okay, which is $50. No matter what you do to it, it will always maintain its value. And those are the slaves of Allah Al-Aziz. Let's say someone beats you up, okay, someone rips you apart, someone does this to you, with all respect, I apologize for doing this. Just an example, okay? Someone spits on it, okay? You do this, you step on it, okay? You go to Costa. Okay, had they accept Canadian, they will take it. It will maintain its value. You go to Canada, the guy said, I don't care, I'll take it. Is it clear? The value is always there, no matter what dunya do to you. But who will always maintain the value? Abdul Aziz. The slaves of Allah Al-Aziz, those who maintain their identity. Those that no matter what the dunya does to them, they will never sell the deen for whatever it takes. Is it clear? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one basically who refuses, the fourth meaning and last, is the one who refuses His slaves to be humiliated. Allah refuses that. The ayah says, وَلَيَنْصُرَنَّ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَنْصُرُهُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَقَوِيٌّ عَزِيزٌ. Allah will give victory to those who give victory to Allah. I want some of you to explain this to me. What does it mean that Allah says, I will give victory to those who give me victory For Allah is the strong, Allah is the almighty. Explain, how can you give Allah victory? How is that possible? How is that understanding? How do you guys understand this? It's very important, isn't that right? How do you understand it? It is when you fulfill the commandments of Allah, that's when you give victory to Allah. And when you do the commandments of Allah, you're doing yourself a favor. Is that clear? So when Allah tells you to pray, don't think that Allah needs your prayer. Allah doesn't need our prayers. We are in desperate need for the prayers. When Allah tells you to do this, you're in desperate need for that. Is it clear? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you to pray. Why? Because at the end of the day, you'll improve your manners. What? Salah improves my manners? Absolutely. You cannot disconnect manners from the ibadat. That's not possible. But Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ what? Ten. You remember the khutbah al-jum'ah? Before أَقِمُ الصَّلَاةَ إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنكَرِ وَالْبَغْيِ etc. وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ. Right? The every ayah that Khatib ends with is that salah helps you avoid vulgar language. Every pillar of Islam helps you improve your manners. Rasulullah said about fasting. He said, when you fast Ramadan, have you not stopped lying and cheating? There's no need for your fasting. Why? Because fasting improves your manners. Everything is like that. Is it clear? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I'll give you victory. When you give me victory is when you fulfill the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way it is supposed to be fulfilled. How about I sum up all these meanings in one story, then we move along with more practicality in our time and age. Is it clear? Just one example. Rasulullah in the Battle of Badr. Battle of Badr, the second year of Hijrah of emigration from Mecca to Medina. He goes there and Abu Sufyan in the caravan goes back to Mecca. However, there's a battle that's about to take place. The Muslims were not so prepared, but all what they were 313. The Kuffar of Quraysh, they were 1,000. So 1,000 versus 313. Muslims had 2 horses. The Kuffar had how many? 300 horses. The Muslims had barely any weapons, no shield, just a sword and that's it. No helmet, no none of that stuff, no body armor. With this being said, as long as Abdul Aziz, you'll be taken care of, as long as you take the means. You cannot say, I'm the slave of Abdul Aziz, and you're sitting in the corner doing nothing. No, you need to do your homework, you need to step up, you need to do everything that you can, and wallahi al-azim, Allah will not disappoint you. Wallahi, Allah will never do that. Is it clear? So 313 against 1,000. Ya Rasulullah, did you do everything that you can? We did everything that we can. We stood up, we made dua, and we also took the means. Whatever sword that we have, we try to sharpen it as much as we can. All the clothing, if we have 2 layers, we wear 2 layers of clothing. Whatever it takes to do all means possible, then don't worry. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised that there's no one that Allah will be with, except that he'll always be what? Victorious. They go into the battlefield. Rasulullah said that what happens? Allah reinforces them with soldiers. Ya Allah, who are your soldiers? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has soldiers that your mind might not comprehend. Allah says in the Quran, وَلِلَّهِ جُنُودُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَزِيزًا حَكِيمًا. To Allah belong the soldiers in the heavens and the earth, right? And Allah is the Almighty, the All Wise. He's mighty and He's wise. In which soldier He sends to you? So amongst you here, what were some of the soldiers that Allah sent to the Muslim army at that time when they took all their means, when they did not sell their identity and they put their trust in Allah Al-Aziz? What were the soldiers that Allah sent? Give it a shot, Bismillah. Angels, Barakallahu Fikum. What else? What else? Huh? Go ahead, give it a shot.
The fear within the hearts of the Muslims.
Okay, beautiful, okay. What else? Beautiful. Allah subhanahu put the fear in their hearts of the enemy, correct? Allah, one of the soldiers of His is that He gave them the ability to sleep. Huh? Sleep is a soldier of Allah? Absolutely. How can you sleep when you know the next day you might get killed, right? Is this almost impossible, right? Next day you're about to get killed, you can't really sleep. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, beautiful ayah, Allah says, إِذْ يُغَشِّيكُمُ النُّعَاسَ أَمَنَةً مِّنْ. When Allah allows the Muslims to fall asleep. And for those that have final exams and they're not really studying really well, how much do they panic? Even myself, I don't mind being frank about this. When I went to propose, okay, to go get married, the moment, alhamdulillah, her father said, yes, we're going on a trip. The trip is from Michigan all the way to New Jersey. You heard about New Jersey before, right? Baltimore area. It's about 10-hour drive. So the plan was to leave at 12 a.m. to get there at 10 a.m. for Al Maghrib Amfest or a course to come there. Is it clear? So the plan was to sleep at 6 p.m. to wake up at 12 a.m. at midnight, now to drive to make it at basically 10 a.m. I tried to go to sleep 6, 7, 8, 9 p.m. I'm not sleeping. Wallahi, I kid you not. 10 p.m., 11 p.m., 11:15 p.m., I sleep. I wake up at what? 12 a.m. I will sleep for 45 minutes. Why? This is the first date with my wife. And like, all stressed out. And that's like a joyful moment, huh? And like, you're so excited. And then we go there, and then her father pops in the car. Bro, we're married. And I just like, let's move on in life. Yeah? He jumps into the car, and we travel for 10 hours. I don't even substitute with a driver's seat. I drive the whole time, all excited. And Allah protected us, alhamdulillah, Pennsylvania. And it was such a long ride. But the point is, all that excitement, and I was unable to sleep. I'm telling you, tomorrow your head might be chopped off. You think, wake me up. Because I might not wake up tomorrow, okay? Just wake me up. I don't need an alarm. You don't need an alarm because you're not even asleep to begin with. Is it clear? There's something to comprehend. Another thing about the moment of stress. The brother who actually took me to the train station in London so I can come with a train to come here. The brother said, I'm a very heavy sleeper. I am this, this, and that. You know what? But we need to go for the train. It's early morning. That brother, he swears by Allah, he woke up not from the alarm, just by himself. Because he's worried. The speaker is about to give a speech to the 150 people, and so I cannot miss it. There's stress. I want you to live this story. That's what I'm trying to get to. So these Sahaba, next morning, you're going to face at least, every one of you will face at least three. Not even one. You guys paying attention? So this being said, Allah allows the Muslims to sleep. Ah, now you appreciate that soldier, didn't you? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what does He allow? He sends another soldier, which is rain. Rain, yes. The rain in a very moderate way. Hakima, don't forget Allah is the All-Wise. He makes it rain in a way that the ground becomes nice and soft. And He makes it rain so hard where? On the other side of the enemy. So the enemy, when they want to walk, becomes so difficult, correct? So how Allah sends that soldier? Then Allah also sends the angels. Brothers and sisters, what 313 are you talking about when Allah is with you? These numbers no longer exist, no longer mean anything. Huh? Paying attention? Numbers mean nothing. We never judge success according to results. You guys paying attention to that or no? As Muslims, we do not judge success according to results. We judge success according to the effort that we put. So I prepare the halaqah. I do everything that I can. I ruin my $50 because of you guys, okay? I do all of that. Okay, and I take every possible means to give the best product from this lecture. At the end of the lecture, 2-3 people only end up showing up. Am I a failure? To ever allow your success to be in the hands of others. For you as a Muslim, success is in the hands of Allah, and all what you care about is how much work you've put in there. Is it clear? Because had we been measured according to success as in terms of results, then some prophets would deserve hellfire. Well, we gotta explain that. I'll explain that definitely. Because if it's all about results, didn't the Prophet ﷺ say in authentic hadith that some prophets will come yawm al-qiyamah, not a single one following them? So you failed, oh Prophet so-and-so. No. I did everything I can. No, then you have the highest level in Jannah. فَأُولَٰئِكَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ النَّبِيِّينَ, the highest of his prophets, even though not a single one accepted him. So we never measure success according to results, rather we put the effort, the Sahaba put the effort, but Allah Al-Aziz will show them the result and taste the sweetness of it. Then Allah sends the angels. The angels come, and now they fight the Sahaba, saying authentic narrations, as about to strike one of the enemies. What happens? I already see his head already flying away. And they see a green mark. Then another one says, Ya Rasulullah, I heard someone say, Uqdum Khayzum! Uqdum Khayzum! What's that? He's like, yes, that's an angel from so-and-so heaven who came to support us. Then Allah sends soldiers, etc., etc., etc. And by the way, do you know that the non-Muslims take pride in that story? For those that know Star Wars, okay? And I actually looked this myself. Star Wars, you know how when they cut someone's hand, or what happens is a green mark, whatever color is, and very sharp and nice cut? The director actually took it from the Battle of Badr. He took honor from an event of Muslims. What about me and you? I'm not thinking to go around and chop someone's people's head. A'udhu billah. And actually I was hesitant to even say the example, but you guys are educated people. Now, as I mentioned all of that, eventually what happened? The Muslims were eventually victorious. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in a beautiful, beautiful way, He concludes this event and He says, وَمَا جَعَلَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بُشْرَى. I love this ayah. Look at the ending. وَمَا جَعَلَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بُشْرَى وَلِتَطْمَئِنَّ بِهِ قُلُوبُكُمْ. All these soldiers for you as a good news, for your heart to come at ease. وَمَا النَّصْرُ إِلَّا مِنْ عِنْدْ. Allah. Victory comes only from Allah. The Sahaba believed in that. They didn't say, oh, we don't have weapons, bro, we're done, man. We're dead. No, they know if I take the means, regardless of how small our numbers were, it does not matter. Then Allah ends it, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. You see how Allah's names explain the whole story for you? So if I knew Allah Al-Aziz, perhaps we didn't even have to know the whole story. But we live it. With this being said, brothers and sisters, very, very important. I have to tune up. Some of brothers get very excited with this stuff. Like, yeah, takbir, right? Al-Aziz, I'm Al-Aziz, right? And they walk around, right? Were you talking to me? Wallahi, I kid you not. Wallahi, I kid you not. There's one brother. Wallahi, he did it in front of me. He was walking. He was so pumped up. He was learning Allah's beautiful names. In that class, about Allah Al-Aziz, specifically, because that name pumps you up so much, by the way. I hope I'm doing a good job. So the brother's walking, and then someone guy says, oh, you guys wash your feet like that? He's like, you see my feet? He took off his shoes. Wallahi, he put it on the table. On the table. Actually, it was a chair, to be very truthful with the story. On the chair. He said, you see my foot? He's like, it's cleaner than your face. I wash it 5 times a day. May Allah reward you for that pride, but that's wrong. That is horrible. Is it? That's you actually make things worse. But the izzah is there. May Allah reward you for it. But that's not the right way to actually do it. That's why Allah Al-Aziz in the Quran, He puts Al-Aziz with other names. Allahu Akbar. What other name does Allah put with Al-Aziz? Hakim, the wise. Be proud, but with wisdom. Isn't that right? Be proud of your deen, but don't be an idiot. Be proud of your deen, but don't ruin the image of the deen. Have the proudness and the pride in a way that is gauged properly. What other name? Allah says, Al-Aziz Al-Rahim. You're mighty but merciful. Because many people have that status of might and power, have no mercy. But Allah tells you, I'm so mighty, but with mercy. Allahu Akbar. And Allah also says, Al-Azizu Al-Alim. I'm mighty with knowledge. So due to His knowledge, now Allah is very mighty. Because it's based upon knowledge. Many people are given positions of might, have no knowledge, have no mercy. They spread corruption. But Allah, Inna Allah la yuhibbul mufsidin. Allah doesn't like those who corrupt. So see how beautiful the names coming together? With this being said, it's balanced. Now, let's look at the remaining of the talk. We're going to end at what time? MashaAllah, that's the one thing you guys all memorize. 3:15. Allah's yani, alhamdulillah. Is it torture? Is it good? Alhamdulillah, may Allah accept. The way we're going to go with the talk, inshaAllah, there are 4 more segments left. Let's see the example of those who sought pride, izzah, identity to be shaped by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And let's look at the other side of those who basically sold their identity or lacked with their identity, and what was the end result. After we mentioned those two, there's a third segment, maybe the time will not permit, so I would skip it, then we'll go to conclusion, an action item. Sounds good? So now what's the segment? Is what are the results? Give us some examples, some real life stories beyond Battle of Badr that we can relate to how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives izzah to the believers, that those that sought Allah al-Aziz. Are you guys paying attention? Number one, and I cannot skip this, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sallallahu alayhi, the best example of the one who trusted Allah, the best example of the one, even though when the people came to him and they said, Ya Muhammad, back in Mecca, said, Ya Muhammad, you know this whole message that you brought to us? It's causing us some problems, okay? It's causing us some problems. In أَرَدْتَ mal, if all what you want is cash, you want money, we'll give you all the money that you want. If you want to be the king of the whole of Mecca, and by the way, that offer of kingship is unbelievable. Why? Because Quraysh never had a king before. Never had a king. So for them to give such offer, they're so desperate. So now, that offer is absolutely amazing, right? You'll be the king of Quraysh. If that's what you want, we'll give it to you. If all what you're doing, because you're a very good looking man, Muhammad was a very handsome man. And actually the stronger opinion is that he was more handsome than Yusuf alayhi salam, because the Prophet said Yusuf was given what? Half of beauty, right? I.e. half of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa beauty. It's unbelievable. It's like, if what you're trying to do is get girls, we'll give you the most beautiful girls in the world. And if you're possessed by jinn, look how disrespectful they were, then we can give you the best doctors to cure you. Then Rasulullah, what did he accept the offer? Did he sell his deen? That was so beautiful identity. Was he like, oh, shut up, you loser, and stabbed in the stomach? Did he do that? He was Aziz, but Hakim. He said, no, thank you. And he moved on his life. He moved on in da'wah. He was tortured. Aziz, Rahim, Aziz, Hakim. And sometimes, and Hakim means go fight, which is in Badr. Right now, I don't see any hikmah on go fighting. And I'll say this out loud for those, maybe the secret services around, and the FBI here around. I don't know what is it called here. I'm not calling to have any unwisdom. Rather, you be wise and have the izzah as well. Yes, we'll enforce that izzah perspective. Is that clear? Rasulullah, with this being said, look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through the izzah, then Allah make him famous. What's the ayah? If you get this, I'll give 1 point. So. What's the ayah that Allah says, we will make you famous? Don't be shy. I can swear most of you know that ayah. The ayah, it says, we will make you famous. I want to show you this ayah because even though he was belittled, even though he was harmed, eventually he became the famous man who was praised, that man whom people loved, and Muhammad never sought fame. That's what Allah made him famous. For those that want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's pleasure, they never seek to be famous. But Allah subhanahu makes him famous, he got no choice. What's the ayah? Beautiful. No, it's a gift. It's a gift. You cannot reject a gift. Bismillah. وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ May Allah honor you. May Allah ارفع ذِكْرَكَ yourself as well. May Allah give you a beautiful reputation and to all of you. Say ameen. وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ They try to humiliate you, try to put you down. No, every single moment in this dunya, as every second we're speaking, someone is praying some tahajjud in Pakistan saying, التحيات لله وصلاة الطيبات. And he says, أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله. Now say hadith صلى الله عليه وسلم back here in England, some other one in Canada, some other one in the States, Venezuela, Argentina, every single moment. That name, Muhammad is being mentioned. Allahu Akbar. He sought Izzah and Allah gave him the Izzah. During his life and after his life. Is that clear? Look, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Abu Bakr Siddiq, after the Prophet passed away, what happened? He became that leader, right? Abu Bakr came, ruled the Muslims. What happened? Some Muslims said, you know what? We want to basically apostate. We want to leave. Then they start corrupting the Muslims. Paying attention to the words. They started to corrupt the Muslims. Like, you know what? No worry about zakah. There's no zakah. Forget this. So you want to leave Islam? Go ahead and do your thing. But now you're corrupting us? Then Abu Bakr Siddiq was told by other people, you know what? Let them pick and choose from Islam. Let them pick and choose whatever they want. Now, once again, I say it once again, this is not for us to apply here. Someone apostates that come here, the hadith says, chop your head off. No, you never do that. We never say that. Exactly. I want to reinforce it, even though I know all you guys know this already, but just to add upon it. So Abu Bakr Siddiq, as a Khalifa, and with his wisdom, he says, أَيَنْقُصُ الدِّينُ وَأَنَا حَيِّ You want the religion to diminish, to decrease while I'm alive? Wallahi, never. Wallahi, never. To relate this to our time, I was giving an episode about Allah Al-Aziz in Huda TV in Egypt. Okay? While I was there, it was about the 26th episode out of 30, in Ramadan. Then I said the ayah, وَلَا يَنْصُرَنَّ اللَّهَ مَنْ يَنْصُرُهُ What did I say? When I said that, let me just confirm. What happened? The director on the phone, he actually, on the microphone, he said, cut. What happened? You never told me that before. I actually never got any connection or disconnect from all the entire students. Alhamdulillah, we were going very well. He said, because you mentioned an ayah that is wrong in terms of tashkil. I'm like, what is it? He said, one of the guys in the studio who was listening to your lecture, you said, وَلَيَنْصُرَنَّ اللَّهَ مَنْ يَنْصُرُهُ So the brother said, it is وَلَيَنْصُرَنَّ اللَّهُ who, not اللَّهَ And I felt, I loved it. I loved it. This is what I'm talking about, pride and izzah in Islam. It's exactly what we're saying. With rahmah, he didn't mock me, he didn't make fun of me. He didn't say, you're a loser, can't even read the ayah properly. You claim to be a havel, you can't even read the ayah. He didn't say that stuff. He said, cut, redo it. Why? Because he said, اللَّهَ, it's اللَّهُ Like Abu Bakr Siddiq, أَيَنْقُصُ الْأَبْسُودُ وَأَنَا حَيِّ Will the episode be diminished? Will people mock the channel because of this? Well, I don't want to embarrass Brother Majid, you know what, we hardly have any time, people will not notice. No! We will take our time, we'll work overtime to correct the ayah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make it said properly. You see the ayah that we're trying to get to? Look at many other people, subhanAllah, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to benefit from this. Say ameen. Other person we'd like to mention, which is in our dunya, in our local time, is a brother in my high school back in Canada. You know the whole handshaking thing, right? Obviously you guys go through this, we handshake. Like just like yesterday, your brother in Imperial College, he said, is it haram to handshake, this and that. Now, I will not go into the fiqh perspective of it, okay? The general understanding is that a man shall never touch a woman that is not supposed to be touched, correct? That's your general understanding. Are there customized fatawa? Yes, I heard some customized fatawa. So if you have something specific, go to your local imam. Maybe he will customize something for you. Because I heard personally from a certain imam who is knowledgeable, he said, you know what, in your case, I heard it. He said, you know, in your case, you can shake hands. It's okay. But make sure you don't do it again, or make sure you explain to her afterwards. Whatever the thing may be. But the general understanding is what? We shall not do that. And why not, if you have the opportunity to mention that I cannot shake hands, and you know that the lady understands, or the guy for the sisters understand that there's Muslims around, and there's room for it, why not? Right? Why be embarrassed? Isn't that right? Isn't it true that there's some people say, oh, I'm allergic, I can't touch you? Isn't that right? At least that we have in North America, oh, I can't shake hands, why? Because I'm allergic, or I'm germophobe, or is that what? Like germs-wise, I don't know what that term comes. Everybody's a phobe these days, there's like a term that comes up. So the point is they never criticize, right? Okay, oh, we respect that. But you're shy about your identity? If you get wrong, why not? So what happened in high school, the graduation ceremony comes, and the Muslims were nervous. I was nervous. I'm like, brother, you know what? The principal was a lady, then she's like, shake her hands in front of everybody, and the picture will be taken, and then give it down, like the brother's like this, and I'm like all excited and degree. And what shall we do? Then one brother, may Allah bless him, Allah khair, he went to her office, very respectful, Aziz, Hakim, Rahim. We can have the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? But to a certain extent. But we will never have the izzah that Allah has. We will never have the wisdom that Allah has. But Allah called us in Surah Al-Insan. فَجَعَلْنَاهُ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا. Isn't that right? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls us in Surah Al-Insan. We are Sami' Basir. But Allah is also Sami' Basir. But in a way that we're different. We never say that we're like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أُوذُ بِاللَّهِ لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. Is that clear? Now that brother goes to the office, says, you know what, miss? We as Muslims, we as opposite gender, we cannot have like handshake or touch or hug, etc. Then she was very nice and she was very kind because he was approached there in a very nice way. He's like, you know what, we Muslims, you know, we don't shake like filthy women like you who don't wear hijab. What? What are you doing? Wallahi al-Azim, I know people get upset when I say that. Wallahi, there's some non-hijabis that have better manners than hijabis. Do you guys agree?
Yes.
Like someone's like, takbir! No, but you should also wear the hijab, correct? Yeah, we want a full package. We want a full package. That's what we said, manners and deen do not separate. We want a full package. I go to, I don't know about you guys, when I went to go like buy a Samsung and so on, I said, I want the phone, I don't want the data plan. You guys, you call data plan? What do you guys say? Data plan, so you guys, okay, relating? What does that say? No, go ahead.
It's more of a contract.
It's a contract, right? So you want the contract, you want that deal, you don't want to pay the full price for the phone. Buy the contract and it will have to come by with internet. I'm like, I don't want the internet. I just want the phone. Sir, you cannot dislocate internet, the data plan from the phone. You have to bring them together for that low price. I'm like, no. It's like, you can't do that. In Islam, better example, you cannot dislocate manners from ibadat. There's no such thing as I pray, I do this, this and that, and I'm rude to my mother. For wallahi, all that what you've done, we may be useless to disrespecting your mother. One time a brother comes in, and wallahi, I saw with my own eyes, a brother, I was with him in the iftar on Ramadan. That's why that tarawih example that came up. And his mom told him to wash the dishes. Then he left and he smacked the door and he left. Do you think that Allah accepted his tarawih? You'd be wrong, man. You'd be wrong if you think this person, this tarawih will benefit him. Because tarawih is sunnah mu'akkada, which means sunnah, where you won't be punished if you missed it. But fulfilling your mom's obligation becomes actually a wajib. Is it clear? Just something to comprehend as Muslims, we have to pay attention to these small things. Now with this being said, that brother went, then afterwards the principal told them, well, as you guys go on the stage, Muslims, just make sure you give us a sign. So they agreed, the brother and the principal was a sign, is this. Allah, let's do this, then we get what you're saying. So then the brother came and said, brothers, sisters, I got you guys. All we have to do when you go on the stage is do this. Allah said, we all came with izzah. We all came with might. Why? Because we went on the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We all came like, and we're all proud. We were so proud. And the principal was so respectful. And I know other people get irritated from this, but take it from a person who lived in both worlds. In the Eastern world, half of my life was in Saudi Arabia, the other half was in North America. I personally think North America and perhaps the UK, my limited knowledge in the UK, I might be wrong in your area, they respect Islam more than Muslim countries. They respect Muslims more than Muslim countries. You know, I was basically invited to go to Egypt again for another whole series about with Al-Huda TV, okay? I was worried to go. Why? Amr ibn al-As took over Egypt, Muslim majority, right? I'm worried to go to Egypt. Why? Because of the beard. Maybe because like, oh, it's mutatarrif, you're extremist. Why? Why did they put in our hearts? I believe actually we live in areas that respect Islam more than others. My brother-in-law is from Tunis, okay? He said at one point in time, you actually had to show your ID to go to Fajr prayers. Isn't that sad? We go there in Canada, Allah, but you guys, so I don't want to judge on you guys. You go to Fajr, you're not worried. SubhanAllah, it's beautiful, isn't that right? So we appreciate that. So that principle accepted. Alhamdulillah, we felt so proud that we maintained our izzah, even though that this community does not care about or did not look into the Muslim identity. We never sold our deen. It was a beautiful feeling that I'm sharing the story with you many, many years later. You see how the sweetness of izzah? But you would never mention a moment of humility. Obviously, we went through it. Is it clear? Now, let's look at the other side. Let's look at others who sold their identity or have shared their identity or they chose something else over Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or they thought, like, remember the concern? They saw other routes to feel respected, but how it went against them. Let's go, for example, with money and job. And actually, this story, if I'm not mistaken, happened in the UK that I'm sharing with you. It was a brother whose name is Muhammad. Muhammad goes and applies for a job. While he applies, he goes for an interview and he feels he's very qualified for the position. The requirements are there and he has fully covered every requirement that they need, even like the preferred qualifications. Everything is there. He goes for the interview, he leaves, he feels so confident. How did the interview go? The interview was as follows. The interviewer asked him, "Oh, Muhammad, what do you do?" He's like, "You can call me Mo." "Is it haram?" "I don't think it's haram. I don't know. I really don't know. I really, since I'm not looking, I don't know. You can be called Mo haram or not. That's not my problem. But what I know is that maybe he was not very proud of Muhammad. Bil'aks, what a beautiful name, ya akhi. Wallahi, my name, what's my last name? Mahmoud, right? You don't understand, like, I almost get in tears when they say, "Are you Majid Muhammad?" I'm like, go with it. Yes, Muhammad. I would be honored to have last name Muhammad. Call me Muhammad. I will spell it as Mahmoud. For how beautiful that name is. You would be called Mo over it? "Your name is Aisha." "My name is Ashley." "You're Aisha." "Aisha. Our mother, Ummul Mu'mineen, mother of the believers. Be proud." But we can never, as Muslims, judge people's intentions. Are you guys clear? We can never. And the moment you judge someone else's intention is the moment you verbalize that your own intention is corrupted. Is it clear? But the thing is, externally speaking, why wouldn't he say Muhammad? Anyways, he went with this. Now, to confirm this understanding that he might have not been proud of his identity, Allahu A'lam, is that he moved forward with the conversation. Then at the end of the interview, the interviewer was perhaps impressed. Then he said, "You as a Muslim, you perhaps need to take an hour or two off on Fridays, right, for your Friday Jumu'ah." He's like, "You know what? You don't have to worry about it." "Why?" "Oh, you don't have to worry about it. I'll make it up when I go back home. You know, after work, I'll just go pray and you don't worry about it." "But your Muslim colleagues here at work, they take..." He's like, "You know what? I'll take care of it." He's like, "Okay, it's up to you. Beautiful." Then a week passes by, 2 weeks passes by. What happens? Mo doesn't get the call. Then he calls back the company. He said, "Hello, I actually had a job interview with you guys. And I didn't get a call back. Is there any problem?" He's like, "Yes, we reviewed the resume, we reviewed the interview, and we felt that there were better candidates." Then he said, "Okay, with all respect, well, what is it that I lacked? What is it that I didn't have? Like, what's the problem? I know that I fulfilled everything." Then she said, "It's, you know, personal reason, whatever." Then he insisted. Then he said, "Okay, we'll tell you." They said, word for word, I'm trying my best to translate. He said, "You were not loyal enough to your own faith. You expect us for you to believe you'll be loyal to your own job? You're not loyal enough for your faith, your own identity. You think we will believe you'll be loyal to your own job?" And that's very powerful. You see, he sought izzah from other source. Give up the salah. Look what happened. Is it clear? And there's many, many, many more examples. Wallahi, an example of this is almost unending. There's another woman in the States, it happened. I don't know if you guys pay attention to some like viral news that happened. There was a, you know how you ever, in the stadium, the camera go around the fans? So the camera one time settled at one fan, and it was a girl who was absolutely marvelous. I'm not saying that I'm staring, but the point is that, let me clarify, ya shabab, just hold on. Now recorded, my wife sees this, by the way, my wife enforced me to wear the ring, I don't know why. This gives me value. That means like, jazakallah khair, you actually feel jealous, alhamdulillah. That's good. Anyways, but you know why she gets upset? Because I wear it in my right hand. Anyways, you guys understand? Because the left hand is really married. But I said that, it's because I promised. This being said, the stadium, the camera focuses on one girl. She was actually the Miss Alabama, the most beautiful girl in Alabama State. The commentator, when the camera zoomed in, he kept saying words that are very, very disturbing. He's like, "Oh my God, how lovely she is. Look at how gorgeous she is, etc. Oh, her boyfriend is so lucky." Like, he actually went to that depth. Her boyfriend was a quarterback in football, American football, by the way. Don't get confused, eh? So American football, the quarterback is one who throws the ball initially. "Oh, he's such a lucky man, etc." For a few seconds, then the camera's on the way. After moments, things went viral. This man sexually harassed, this man is disrespectful. He was over 70 years old. Why would you do this? What's wrong with you? Do you know how many hundreds of thousands of people, by the way, it's almost perhaps the number one sport, almost, or amongst the top three in the States. People watch it like crazy. The most watched program recently is the Super Bowl. You guys know Super Bowl? That's how famous it is, right? That's how people watch football. They basically so focused into it. The next day happened what? An interview with that lady. Pay attention. Generally, a respectful woman, she will not appreciate that, right? You saying these comments about me and all these people watching, you think my boyfriend will appreciate that, right? As a man, if someone said that about your wife, do you think you appreciate that? "Oh, thank you, man. I told her to wear like that so she can look gorgeous." People don't do that stuff, right? Generally, as a man. You know what she said? She was asked, "Did you feel like disrespected or humiliated? Like, we apologize for it." It was ESPN, if I'm not mistaken. She said, "Actually, no, I loved it." I loved it. It was amazing. I have no problem with it. But why? Wallahi, I kid you not. She said, just a couple of days ago, I had about 2,000 followers on Twitter. After these comments, I have over 200,000 followers on Twitter. So she chose, see, the izzah was sold for the sake of followers on Twitter. Allahu Akbar, just paying attention. And according to Islam, according to our Sharia understanding, whoever, not this girl, whoever seeks izzah from any other source besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you sell your deen, you sell your fitrah, your innate nature, you'll be eventually humiliated. These followers will never benefit you. Is it clear? So Allahu Akbar, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to allow us to fall in that trap. It happens many times, right? Now, what other sources people try to seek? Fame was one, money was one, the other one is friends. I gotta look cool, I gotta have bigger friends, right? I need more followers, more likes, etc. I wanna basically blend in, right? And to me, the most difficult source to get away from and to go back to Allah is friends. Very pressuring, very pressuring. I'll give you an example. I used to work in a restaurant for 5 years, and I'm not shy to say that. 5 years throughout high school, throughout university, I used to basically wrap shawarmas, okay? Whatever you guys want, inshallah, we'll do for you, inshallah, after the halaqah, okay? The point being is that eventually your friends come. And just please live the example. If you ever had a job like that, if you never did, just live it. So I work, your friend comes in. You gotta look cool, right? What's the cool? Discount. Extra chicken, extra sauce, pita bread here and there, right? No one knows. Halas. So the brother says, you know what? Hey, brother, imagine. Extra chicken. Zabbat, yani, hook it up. Okay? But it's a 150 extra. Like $1.50 extra. Now the question is, Allah's watching you. Allah is Al-Aziz, you want Izzah, you want honor, you want might, or you're going to sell it for a friend of yours. Even though he's going to call your names. Maybe he's going to walk on campus saying what? Oh, brother, man is stingy, don't ever walk to that place, right? Even though he might reduce the number of customers because he's going to give bad comments, but who's a Razzaq? Who provides? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So me as Majid, what will I do? What did I do? I'll share this with myself. But the question that comes, if you go through that case, what will you do? And be honest with yourself. Will you put the extra chicken? Will you not? Or would you tell him, brother, it will cost 150? Or he'll be very nervous and he'll be actually like shivering. Or would he say, yeah, brother, I got you, man. You put extra chicken and he leaves it, you put your own 150. So you try to be cool and you try to like balance between both. What will you do? Another brother, one time what happened, he drove in the street, he parked in a handicapped place. I guess you guys have a handicapped place, correct? So he parked in a handicapped place and he was not handicapped. He had the tag from his mother. There was a cop who noticed that the brother was healthy. He left the car, there was no mother with him, there's nothing, completely. He parked the car, then he went to campus. Afterwards, he left to us in Canada, it's a very big fee. About you get about $350, which is pretty significant. It's about like maybe £200. So he got that ticket, then he called me up. He's like, brother Malik, salaam alaikum salam. He's like, I got this ticket for handicap. It's really expensive, and as students, this is a big number for us. The only way I can waive that fee is if someone gives a testimonial or witnesses and says, well, he went to pick up his mother. So can I reference you that you witnessed that I actually came with my mother and now I'm trying to bring her back from an appointment or whatever? How difficult was this? That was very intense. He's like, just a signature. That's all you need. I'm done. It's not a serious case. I'm not going to go to court and go meet a judge. No, just sign. That's all you got to do. What would you do? What would you do? You see what I'm trying to do with izzah and hikmah? Yes, you're proud of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the laws. And you can only, as a Muslim, lie in three cases. And this is not one of them. This is not one of them. This is some serious sin. What will you do? Wallahi, just live the example. Will you go and say, okay, I will sign that I witnessed. I actually called them up and I told them, really, was your mother with you? He's like, no, she wasn't. Well, what did I do? Don't worry about what I did. That's not the question. The question is, what will you do? What did you get from this talk? That's why I'm trying to get the whole point of this halaqah is that izzah, your identity, is to be shaped by the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and wallahi will be victorious. I'm pretty sure if I told him, no, I can't do this, this guy will never probably talk to me again. This guy will tell others, this guy is just an idiot. He basically, whenever a true friend, he sees you falling, he carries you up and all these quotes, right? You were falling, but you're trying to make me fall along with you. And me helping you out is by telling you, no, I can't do it. And me telling you that will tell you and confirm that next time you do it, you will not park there in that parking spot. Why? Because you got good friends that woke you up. But what did I do? That's not the question. The question is, what will you do? Is it clear? So things like that end up coming up more and more and more. With this being said, I only got a few minutes left. And as I promised, and I try to fulfill that promise. Because part of respecting you is when I respect your timing. When we will end? 3:15. And what time is it? 3:12. 312. Let me look at your time. MashaAllah. Beautiful. 312. Beautiful. 312. So I got 3 minutes. Halas? Let's conclude, brothers and sisters. Let's conclude. Any questions so far? Write it down on a piece of paper. And inshallah, if time permits, we will get back to you guys. And inshallah, we'll respond. Is it clear? طيب. Bismillah. Now, action items. I have three for you. Three for you. To gain the izzah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number one. Do not accept to be humiliated. Do not accept to be bullied in school. You go and complain to the authorities, regardless of your age. People were bullied at university. Wallah, I know someone who was bullied at university, college, one who was married, one who was a grandfather, he was bullied. Bully is less, there's no age limit. Is it clear? And be honest with yourself whether you're bullied or not. Okay? Whether a sister is sexually harassed or not. Don't allow yourself to be humiliated whatsoever, regardless of the consequences. Is it clear? Be the person who leaves the area of humility. If you're a person who humiliate your own self, every time you cheat an exam, you're humiliating your own self. You're degrading your own self. Leave that area. Your marks will go down, but don't worry, Allah will give you izzah. Allah will reinforce you, but show Allah that you're trying. Is it clear? Be like Sumayya, radiallahu anha. Allah honored the entire ummah of Muhammad sallam, that the first martyr is a sister, not a brother. To look up to her. Why? Because Sumayya, when she was tortured from Ali Yasir, from that family of Ali Yasir, she was tortured, crucified, back and forth, and Abu Jahl and the enemy say, just retreat from Islam. Never, 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 even though she was allowed. But she didn't want to, not even that option was to use. She said, La ilaha illallah, this is my izzah. And then eventually what happened? They went and they stabbed her and she died. She became the first martyr of Islam. I ask you by Allah, who was the one humiliated? Was it Sumayya or Abu Jahl? The whole ummah, even the kuffar knew that Abu Jahl, you're the one who was humiliated. Because you were not able to take over a single girl. Didn't see one who was honored, and I mentioned her name until today, she's the one who was honored. So leave that area, no matter how long it takes you, and you might die without leaving that circle of humility. But at least, ya Allah, I'm trying. Is it clear? For those that have been blackmailed, the sisters, I know true stories of girls who fell into dating with other guys and showed these images and these pictures without hijab or even without clothing. And I'm telling you personal stories. I know of others in Canada. Eventually what happened, when they broke up, he stopped blackmailing. Refuse that. And get out of it and do something about it. Don't accept humility. Is it clear? Point number two, help Muslims gain might. Help your brothers and sisters. You saw someone being bullied, someone sexually harassed, etc. Help them out. Give them from the izzah that Allah has given you with, along with wisdom. Is it clear? One time there was a sister who was filling gas in the States. While she was filling gas, and she was a Somali sister wearing hijab. And then someone comes up who was like Islamophobe, makes fun of her, oh, you're racist, oh, you're terrorist, oh, this, this, and that. You scumbag, and all these horrible words. Go back to your country. You know what happened afterwards? The news reporters came and they saw this as on the camera in the gas station and they asked her, how did you feel? She said, I felt miserable. I felt horrible. But you know why? Not because of these comments. Why? Because there's a brother filling gas right there who didn't do anything about it. Who didn't come and support his sister. That's what killed me. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, everything that I mentioned is authentic. Except this one that has some weakness in it. Some ulama say, da'if. Man adhilla indahu mu'min falam yansur. Whoever sees a brother or a sister being humiliated, and it has some truth to it, na'am. Whoever sees a brother or a sister being humiliated in front of them, وَلَمْ يَنْصُرْ, you don't give them victory in a very wise manner, what will happen? أَذَلَّهَ اللَّهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Allah will humiliate that person in front of the billions of people on the day of judgment. May Allah make us among those who reinforces all of brothers and sisters with might and izzah and make them feel proud of their identity. Say ameen. We ask Allah to bless all of us. Lastly, humble yourself. You just said don't do that. No. Humble yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the more you humble yourself to Allah, the more Allah honors you. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Man tawadha lillahi hakadha," whoever humbles themselves to Allah, humble yourself to Allah, Allah will elevate you. And Allah yu'izzak, wa yu'izzak, and honor you. Amongst those you humble yourself to is people around you. Don't be the arrogant man. Be the humble man along with pride. Yes, you can combine both, especially with your mom and dad. Your mom tells you, you know what, put the papers like this, but mama, it doesn't make any sense, right? It doesn't make sense. No, put the table, mama, it's not even equal. I'm an engineering student. Doesn't matter. Humble yourself. Okay. Will you die from this? No. Humble yourself so Allah can give you might. Humble yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make all of us die upon La ilaha illallah. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to always allow us to be proud of our identity and never allow any dunya materialistic thing to allow us to sell our deen. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make sure to allow us to have that pride along with wisdom and mercy. Barakallahu fiikum. Jazakum Allah khair. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.